Hello, my feline friends. This is Una Kitten. In our last episode, we returned to the lodge where we were given Sarah's belongings and then spoke to Mateo. Something the hunter told us about Unity struck a chord with him, and he wants to follow the thread. We went with him to the Sanctum Universum to speak to Keeper Aquilus. The Keeper told us of a pilgrim a long time ago who spoke to them about Unity and gave us the clue Infinity Addendum. He then told us that House of the Enlightenment have a similar story of Unity, and so do the House of Arun. We went to the House of Enlightenment and spoke to Andy Singh. Andy told us of a story about a drifter that came to them in the House of Enlightenment and argued daily, the same argument always. He would constantly say second and two. Finally, we spoke to a Varun prisoner by the name of Mirza. She told us of how Jinan Varun meets with the pilgrim, the unbeliever, and they fight four battles during 120 rotations, or days. We returned to the Keeper, and together we guessed the clues that would lead us to the pilgrim's resting place on the second planet in the Indum system. We traveled there and discovered more clues to follow. Then, to find the scorpion on Hyla 2. We found some kind of star chart. It told us to go to the last star in the scorpion's thing. We traveled to the Borum 3 system, and of course the hunter is there. We get invited to a meeting he is having between himself and the emissary, the first starborn to attack us. They were discussing us, actually. They are the starborn. They are Sarah and the Keeper from the universe, from other universes, like a multiverse. They traveled the settled systems through thousands of universes in order to collect artifacts at all costs. They each one tells us to pick one over the other, search for more artifacts together. We haven't decided yet, however, the emissary wants us to travel to the old moon of Earth for further clarification. Join me in today's episode where we will further our storyline and tell Constellation what we've learned. So we're first going to go speak to Vladimir on the Eye to get more possible coordinates of the powers and artifacts and things. And then after that, we're going to go to New Atlantis to the lodge to tell everybody there what we've learned so far. Then we're going to travel to the moon of Earth. This picture kind of makes me think that they're telling us that we should pickpocket her. I would like to know what she has worth stealing.
New Atlantis is gorgeous, but it's all built on lies.
That Vladimir was on the Eye. I guess he's not.
Exploration still lives as long as the lodge is still standing.
Yeah.
Hey, I've been talking with the others, and I'd like to get everyone together to say goodbye.
I already did that.
You know.
It was kind of bad, but I did do a memorial. I'll be there, Noelle. I promise. I'll try, but you never know with me. Always pulled here and there. No, I can't. I just can't.
Yeah. Of course. Just keep it in mind. Okay? I'll have everything set up in a few days.
Okay. I already did it. I beat you to it.
Mateo told us about the Pilgrim's Voyage.
You found it, didn't you? The meaning of unity.
It's the center of a multiverse. We're building the way to it. There's an infinite number of me out there. Feel sorry for all of them. Sarah's alive. A version of her from another universe.
Wait. Say that again. Multiple universes? You can't possibly mean what I think you mean.
Yes, I wouldn't mind a little more detail.
I met a version of Sarah. She told me the Unity creates the Starborn, and they can cross universes. Apparently, in another universe, I died, and Sarah lived. She's the emissary now, a Starborn. Trust me, there's multiple universes. The Unity is how we get to them. It makes you Starborn. I met a version of Sarah.
I don't even want to think about the physiological changes you'd need to travel between universes.
Plus what it would do to the mind? Enlightenment? Or oblivion? Like the Hunter.
You have the opportunity to reach the closest thing to your god that might exist. And you're second-guessing?
One doesn't approach the afterlife without some trepidation.
This is our mission, to go into the unknown. Think of what awaits us, a new life, the powers of the Starborn. We should all take time to think about what this means. This is our mission.
You're right. We have to see the Unity for ourselves.
Not to make a sharp turn in a grand tale, but I got the eye fixed up. Bruised, but still blinking. Let me know when you're ready to follow up on what it's seen.
That's why I came to talk to you. In the first place.
These last glimpses from the eye are from the farthest fringes of known space. Could be the only remaining pieces outside the hands of the Starborn.
Thanks, Vladimir. I'll follow up on these. I'm not quite ready to look for more artifacts. Remember when D space was our only problem? Yeah.
Aye. The Blackest Sea seems less of a concern when there are sharks leaping out at you.
Thanks, Vladimir. I'll follow up on these.
Catch a smile out there.
Thanks. You need a ship with a grav drive jump of 21 ly to reach your destination. Grav jump range is influenced by the ship's grav drive, the ship's mass, and your astrodynamic skills. All right. So, in other words, you're telling me I can't go that far. Got it. Current ship can go 17. That's a bit off. Four. I need four more. I'm not sure if I have a ship that can go 21. Ooh. Alright, so we're at a research facility right outside. Or on Earth, or the moon. I'm guessing it's on the moon. Seems abandoned. At least on the outside. Gave us stuff that's supposed to let us get in. That's why we're able to get in. Yeah, it's pretty abandoned. We'll take that key, thank you. Nova Galactic Computer. Alright. Voltaire. Voltaire, I wanted to remind the research team that Voltaire is a highly proprietary supercomputer that is currently being contracted exclusively for the use in Project Prism. It is not meant for your own personal projects. Yes, it's amusing to see just how many decimal points of pi it can calculate, how many bits of encryption it can brute force, or whether you can simulate table tennis with a perfect aerodynamic simulation, but there will be time for that later. For now, I need everyone concentrating on hitting our deadline. We're developing exciting new aerospace technology with our partner and client. That should be more than enough to keep anyone from being bored. Project Prism launch. We're happy to announce that the first test launch of Project Prism will be held today. I would like everyone to suit up and join us on the roof at 900 EDT, Reminder to please sync all watches to Eastern Daylight Time. Our partner will also be on radio for the launch. We'll be recording the event, so be on your best behavior. Wonder if that's that ship that we found a while back when we were working with the Ryujin. Artificial AI.
This is genuine NASA tech. Whew, goosebumps.
Well, I mean, it's NASA, but at this point, NASA is outdated. Just saying. That would be devastating to work probably, you know, decades of years on. Ooh, there's four slates. So I'm going to go back and get slate, see if I can find slate one before I re-slate four. I wasn't really looking for slates. Hope I don't have to go all the way back outside. I just might. Alright, I guess. Come on, Sammy. Let's go back outside and see if we can find the slate one. Start from the beginning. Everything still works for this abandoned station. Sammy, you might want to put on some, you know, protective gear. We're on the moon. There is no atmosphere here. Seriously, Sammy, you can't breathe on this planet, or on this moon. First slate would be. Oh, that was a different direction. I didn't come in this way before. Number three. I should just collect number three and then read it later so I don't lose track of it.
Voltaire really is something else. A supercomputer so powerful they they put it on the damn moon to keep it cool. Although by that logic, they should be running it purely in the vacuum of space. But hey, good marketing material. I've been spending some off hours running some dumb simulations, just because I can. My favorite so far is simulating the sound of every duck on Earth quacking after receiving a piece of bread. You didn't know you wanted a real-time sim of feeding all the ducks, but now you have it. You're welcome, humanity.
Alright, digipick. Christmas Carol. Kind of seems apt since we just had Christmas.
Bingo. Let's see what we got.
Sammy, why don't you help me look for this? Oh, there's one. Oh, it's kind of hidden there.
You ever get jealous? You know, the crew in the shipyard? Building the actual vessels that are going to travel the stars?
We're literally on a base on the moon.
Oh, come on, Sabina. I'm trying to share my dreams here.
Well, your dreams are always out there and never here where the rest of us live. Can't you just be happy doing your job?
Where's the fun in that?
Here's two.
Nova Galactic Project Log, Principal Engineer Lang Shu. I admit, not the most disciplined team I've ever run. Malcolm keeps stealing computational time on Voltaire and thinks I don't know this. And Sabina's been distracted lately, but won't tell anyone why. I really should demand answers from both of them. But honestly, I'm too preoccupied with this contract. We all are. Despite anything going on in our personal lives, there's something special about what we're building here.
The assignment up here, we were told to bring a couple of personal items. Some psychological study said it helped when you're away from Earth this long. I brought my grandmother's old abacus. I would play with it on her lap, and she'd teach me the Russian for all the numbers. She, got word that she passed. The next shuttle isn't for 3 months, so I won't be able to go to the funeral.
That sucks.
Goodbye, Babushka. Thank you for teaching me math. It brought me to the moon.
I would like to go to the moon without having to learn the math, because I suck at math. but I'm pretty sure I could be a great astronaut. Just don't ask me the math. Just got a couple more slates yet. Only slate I'm missing is slate 4, I believe. I know I saw it, but I didn't pick it up when I saw it. Now I'm not exactly sure where I saw it. I want to say it's by the entrance to where we originally came in. I just picked it up when I saw it. Oh, there it is.
Okay, confession time. Being single on a moon base is the worst. I only get like an hour to use the communication link to Earth every couple of days. And let me tell you, there's long distance dating, and then there's like long distance dating, you know? Oh, hey there, I'm a scientist, deadly employed, willing to take you out for coffee in like 6 months when I'm back from space. It's not a great opening line.
You seriously can't get a date? You're an astronaut. Hey, no one asked you.
Play the recordings on the roof. Well, that's weird.
Spin up time almost complete. Total time 5 minutes 22 seconds. Right on schedule.
How are the helium 3 valves holding, Nova?
We double checked the leakage concerns this morning before the launch. All signs green.
Any changes to the calculation sequence from Voltaire?
No changes since we uploaded the last figures yesterday. It's a clean shot from here to Jupiter.
One day the computer will be on board the spaceship. Just imagine that.
One miracle of science at a time. Counting down. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Canal, are you really?
All clear, Nova. Indicators look good. The ship should be cruising Jupiter's orbit right now. Visual confirmation will be possible in 32 minutes. Afraid the speed of light is on the slow side these days.
How does it feel to break the laws of physics, Canaveral?
We're all pretty excited down here in NASA, I won't lie.
Excited enough to tell me where you got the original data?
Not in a million years.
Interesting. All right, go to NASA. Oh, NASA on Earth? NASA on Earth. I kind of have the feeling that for us in real life, it's going to take some, like, advanced species that gives us technology before we can really travel space and go light speed or actual travel speed so that we can get somewhere. Even has an old spaceship they never finished attached. Noise. A little bit of a maze in here. Oh, he scared me, Sammy.
Story. You just feel it. go, baby? And why didn't you get there?
Ooh, a snow globe. I had gotten snow globes from the other locations of Earth, but I had like a specific quest for them, so I didn't expect to find one here. Another one looks exactly like the one we just picked up. I'm guessing they don't qualify for that snow globe quest. It looks like a gigantic digipick. Not gonna do that much theft if you have to carry a digipick that size around. Power cell to power cell, got it. Alright, well that started something up. Yeah, we get an elevator now. I don't know if I really want to ride an elevator in like this ancient facility. Information about NASA. Alright, we're looking.
Pre-flight check. Remember, no agricultural products passed here. And hit up the duty-free first.
Alright, thanks for the dad joke, Sammy. Launch procedures. Remember, the final vitals and suit sealed checks are essential. Yes, we've come a long way as far as tolerances. Yes, the number of people cleared for launch is much higher than it used to be, but these people's lives are still in our hands. I know there's rumors that the next launch is slated to be canceled, but let's not have that be on us. Assume it's go time every time. Your professionalism is what makes space travel just a little bit safer, and we can use every ounce we can get. Access station logs. Error. Archives damage. Running system recovery. Partial archives retrieved. Delivery from Mars.
Station log. Dr. Judith Tatian. The recent delivery from Mars is unsettling. I was expecting rock samples or maybe fossils of microbial life. Instead, Dr. Victor Isa comes with two members of the military. Everything they brought back is under wraps. theoretical physicist need with a sample from Mars?
This is interesting information. Dr. Victor Eisen.
Dr. Judith Tartien. I've been trying to call you up to Dr. Eisen, Victor, to see what is going on. His team has completely commandeered one of the labs with those two military handlers, checking who comes in and out. I joked that maybe he found a little gray man doing an autopsy, and he grew very pale. 2 days later, he sends me a request asking for more information on my background in material science, metallurgical engineering. Oh, we have a meeting tomorrow. I think I'm being invited into the lab.
Interesting. Reading today.
Dr. Judith Tartien. I have never been so nervous since I defended my dissertation. 4 hours talking to Victor and his team about theoretical metals, atomic bonding, even a half hour diversion into magnetism that I'm pretty sure was to throw me off the trail of what we were actually talking about. Then I got to see the lab. I don't know how much I should say, but the periodic table just got thrown out the window.
Well, sounds like they found their first artifact. And of course, the military would have their hand in it. Very big. Have there ever been any caves located on the moon? And have we explored them? I want to see a moon cave. This is gigantic.
This is so cool.
It's kind of creepy.
I spent hours down here.
Lots of pamphlets. This place is super creepy. See, they had ground transportation previously. From 1971 to 1972, the lunar rover was used for the last Apollo missions and could carry 2 astronauts. The chevron tread patterns on the wheels were made from titanium to help maintain traction on the moon's surface. The rover was also fully electric and ran on batteries, whose power was intended to last for the duration of the mission. Alright, can I take it with me? I guess not. Dang it. Mercury suit. Adapted from a design originally intended for high-altitude aircraft, the Mercury spacesuit would undergo several modifications to deal with pressure, oxygen, and thermal considerations. Even though the cabin of the Mercury spacecraft itself protected against the rigors of space travel, redundancy has always been key. In the event that the cabin were to depressurize and expose astronauts to the vacuum of space, the Mercury spacesuits would be able to offer a critical extra layer of defense. At least you hope so. From 1958 to 1963, One of the humanity's first human spaceflight programs, the Mercury spacecraft was designed to fit a single person who would be sent to test a person's ability to function in space. 6 flights in total were launched, the earliest being a 15-minute suborbital flight, and the last being over 34 hours and 22 complete orbits. Project Gemini. From 1965 to 1966, in many ways, Project Gemini was a learning mission, while NASA's ultimate goal was to put a human being on the moon. Many questions had to be answered before that project, Apollo, could even begin. Gemini was tasked with answering how a person could survive in space over many days, how to connect spacecraft together, and how to improve spacesuit technology to operate outside of spacecraft. Leaving Earth forever. In 2150, scientists first predicted the destruction of our beloved Earth. Atmospheric phenomena would cause breathable air to sputter outside of Earth's gravity, dooming all life that remained. An estimated 50 years until the end has given NASA and other space agencies around the world the opportunity to migrate humanity away from the certain death and into the stars, thanks in part to the development of the grav drive. Humanity will live on. All right, well, tell us more about this grav drive. F1 engine. Developed for the Apollo mission to research Earth's moon, the F1 engine was a single nozzle, liquid-fueled rocket engine that would generate over 6 million neutrons of thrust each. 5 of these would be used in the Saturn V super heavy lift launch vehicle. The power of the F1 was critical in providing the necessary lift to launch rockets from the surface of Earth towards the stars. Lunar Module Eagle. From the Apollo 11 mission, the Lunar Module Eagle was the first crewed spacecraft to touch down on Earth's moon. Eagle's counterpart was the Command Module Columbia, which the Lunar Module needed to both separate from eventually reattach to. Columbia would take astronauts to and from the orbit of the moon, while Eagle would bring them to and from the surface. Project PRISM. NASA partnered with Nova Galactic, the creators of the Voltaire supercomputer, on an ambitious aerospace project to pull gravity itself. The result is the first spacecraft capable of faster-than-light travel. The first successful voyage saw astronauts reaching Jupiter in moments, what would have previously taken years. NASA partner with Nova Galactic, the creator. Oh, it's just the same stuff. Just different display, though. Alright, what is this? Living outside Earth. While long-term missions in space began in the late 1990s with programs such as the International Space Station, humanity began living on other planets almost 100 years later. Small outposts of five or fewer scientific research teams eventually gave way to entire colony effort on Mars and other orbiting bodies of our solar system. There's some kind of alien creature in this building. Closed for remodel. Thank you for your patience. People been waiting a long time for that remodel. Very long. Slate.
I just don't understand where these calculations came from.
There's something wrong with the math. I think it's quite straightforward.
That's not what I'm asking. We've had no success extracting even a sample of material from the object. No explanation for the gravitational effects. No motion graph to explain its harmonic frequency.
No.
I can't
this
even
looks
examine
like
the melting point.
Artifact area.
But you've had me building these prototype colliders for months. And now you want me to pump helium into it based on this equation you've written on a goddamn napkin?
I just need you to trust me.
I have been trusting. We keep slamming our heads against the brick walls, getting nothing.
This is history.
And you keep coming up with something
this is what I figured
like,
out.
Like, you know what's going to happen.
The hard science, the
science. Where are you getting your information,
on.
Victor?
I'm sorry, Judith. I... Look, not here, okay? Somewhere off base. I'll tell you everything. I'm not lying, okay? We're going to discover something important here. I promise.
The creepy banging sounds to not be a thing.
Too bad about the cave-in. But at least the museum was intact.
Yeah, because that's super important right now, Sammy. Behind this locked door. Almost getting rusty, haven't had to use digipicks in the last couple of episodes. power required. Oh, I got a lot. I took one of those battery thingies. Where do I put it? There we go. This looks like a power thingy. Oh, I didn't even take it that I need it. Oh. Didn't even need my little power thing that I've picked up. Another one of those batteries, though. Key. At least it's giving me plenty of digipicks. I saw a key or something over there. Did not. Another snow globe. Think I got plenty of them now. Alright. Nice creepy echo of power getting turned on. Because that's what we need in this empty place. You guys hear that door open? Oh, here. Current.
Sometimes I feel sorry for them. Well,
I don't. They want to kill us, Sammy. You think, Sammy? You think we have company? Someone obviously wanted to protect this area with turrets and robots. Thank you, robot. Hear that? Another door opening. Who else is here? So you see him running over there like he's about to open this door? Oh, it's a little late now. I don't need turret stuff. I already killed them.
Just how far does this complex go?
Very far. Really too far to be going in and seeing if there's a monster at the very end. Because it's a long ways to try to run away. Alright. Security procedures. Check all badges before allowing access. Yes, even the generals. I don't care how angry they get. These are direct orders from the secretary. Absolutely no phones or recording devices. All written materials, clipboards, notebooks are to be checked on exit from the labs. Confiscate anything with confidential information on it. Error, archives damage, running system recovery, partial archives retrieved. April 14th, 2138.
Project log. Dr. Victor Issa. We turned on the prototype today. The gravitational field around it began to fold as we long suspected. Complete reversal of gravitational pull was observed on dozens of loose objects around the lab. I'm setting up a meeting with the directors to propose a larger test. The prototype proves we don't need the original anymore. But further work is going to have to take place in space. Somewhere with abundant helium-3 and with a civilian partner. Someone with access to large-scale manufacturing resources and computational equipment. Engineering gravitational folds pulling the far side of the solar system closer to us? It's all going to be possible.
Interesting.
Hi,
September 8th, 2141.
I watched the Gravjet test from the moon today. It was the first time we were able to talk to the team at Nova Galactic directly. So many things were under wraps before, but now everyone wants all the publicity they can get. I'm already seeing proposals for manufacturing androids of drives, expeditions to Alpha Centauri and beyond. It's also overwhelming and worrying. It could take years, decades, before we know what all the side effects of operating a grad drive can be. But no one wants to hear that right now. Like a bunch of pioneers racing towards the edges of the frontier without knowing about the grizzly bears in the mountains.
Okay.
I wonder what they store here.
Something that wants to kill us, probably. Oh, wow, look how far that goes. Float up and down. Come on, Sammy. Ooh, someone died down there. It's the first human death we've seen. Ooh, he's been dead a minute.
Grizzly, but part of the job.
Yeah. Having fun up there on the ceiling there, Sammy? Did they leave, like, their grab drive on something? Good thing that noise is done. In there. Another guy. He was shot pretty badly. Another key. Prototype drive. Please be careful whenever running power through the prototype. Secure all loose objects and have researchers empty pockets and remove jewelry, watches, etc. Reminder that the core of the drive contains a specimen that is irreplaceable and all data is under the strictest clearance. Exercise all caution with all research materials and ensure information does not leave this lab. Well, now I need to know what that core is. February 12th, 2149.
History now. Only thing we're doing these days is launching weather satellites. Guess this is as good a retirement as any. Now, Project Demeter, you want our help manufacturing scanners to better track these new meteorological patterns we've seen.
Our guess is that the poles might be naturally shifting, causing some gravitational fluctuations that are throwing off our old models.
Why do you need the scanning tolerances to be so small? What are you trying to find?
Want to be sure. It's not like we're doing much these days anyway. The glory days are over. Why not give ourselves a challenge before they write us off in the history books?
Interesting. August 21, 2149. To Judith Victor Isa Juan. As requested, astrophysics research team has done a full analysis of the data you provided us. The measurements of the Earth's magnetic sphere show clear signs of fluctuation, often in correlation to the periods of frequent and large gravity wave spikes emanating from the Moon. These gravity waves seem to be affecting the magnetic shield provided by the Earth's inner core and may be affecting the core itself, given the proximity to the source. The data indicates the change rate is increasingly exponentially. As our magnetic sphere falters, its ability to protect us from the sun's solar wind falters. Beyond the devastating effects of solar radiation, this will lead to something more dire, the sputtering or stripping away of our atmosphere. This has happened before to Mars, a planet studied since its earliest days of space to see if Earth's possible future. We are afraid this feature may be closer than we ever thought imaginable. Some may view this data as normal. There have been historical fluctuations and polarity changes of Earth's core, but this is orders of magnitude greater. We see echoes of previous generations' debates over global warming, and we want the science here to be clear. Like waves in the ocean, these gravity waves rise and eventually crash into shore, the Earth with devastating consequences. Dr. Luke Andrews, ART Chief Scientist. So they destroyed Earth with the grab jives. I was wondering how that happened. August
22, 2149. I know what I've seen, Victor. The data coming back from the satellite is very clear. It's the grab drive.
All those jumps from the moon. At this rate, Earth's atmosphere is going to start
generations, across all time.
At the expense of our home.
Stop it, both of you. All the Nexus is building enough ships to get everyone off this planet. And we need to start now. I'll draft up a statement. We'll need to address the entire international community. I'm sorry, Judith.
There isn't a planet in this universe that'll be far enough away from you, Victor. We are never speaking again after this is over.
Wow. September 8th, 2160.
My name is Dr. Victor Isa, and if you're listening to this, then you probably already know the truth. I was young when I first headed the retrieval team of an odd gravitational anomaly on Mars, but I kept what really happened that day hidden from everyone except one other person. Even she didn't believe me at first, but I have no reason to lie to anyone now, so I hope you'll accept this confession, whoever you are. When I touched the anomaly, I experienced 12 days of lost time. I met myself. He told me everything that has since come true. The grav drive equations, the tests on the moon, Earth's atmosphere sputtering away because of what we had done. But he also told me about a city thriving on a planet orbiting a distant star. Human culture, art, music, lifestyles evolving and shining brightly across all of space. What price would I be willing to pay for that future? Maybe you don't believe me. Maybe Judith was right and I'm just a coward who wants to believe his mistakes were justified. But everyone has forgotten about the real origins of the grav drive, this artifact from Mars. I hope you make better use of it than I did.
Well, thanks. I was suspecting this. All right. It says we gotta release the grav drive, or the artifact. Must be in there.
Thank you.
Sammy, let's go. Few of them too. We don't normally battle this many at one time. Oh no no, don't run at me. That was not nice. No, stay where you are. Okay. Do not need you charging at me. There you are. So, we now know how humans got graph drive, but it still doesn't explain where the artifacts came from or how they were developed in the first place. Humans just reverse engineered it. Robot. Only see Starborn though. Well, that sucks to be you. You should wear goggles or something. Safety glasses. Oh, you missed. Oh, got you. knew it was going to be a pain in the rear to get out of this place. Is that all the Starborn? Get through. You have to come over here and get me. Where are you? I hear you, but I don't see you. Oh, that's Sammy.
Gotta get your blood pumping, huh?
Yeah, but you know, kind of want to see them. Being here, the gravity, when I do the gravity thing, just like really throws them further up in the air. Almost like there's just like no gravity here on this planet. Well, on Earth. Which I guess the gravity has changed, but. Starborn are still not as creepy as all the creaking sounds. The creaking sounds just make me think there's like an actual monster, like a Terramorph or something in here. Would have been nice to have had an elevator a while ago. Let me have one of your ships, emissary.
Do you understand now why I asked you to come here? The artifacts unlocked the secret of interstellar travel at the cost of Earth.
An easy trade, honestly. Why have one world when you can have all the settled systems?
Sacrificing Earth wasn't worth having grav drives. We lost our home. I agree, humanity's destiny was the stars anyway. I still don't quite understand what I found. Can you explain?
Don't you see? The power of the artifact forced humanity to the stars. They didn't get to make a choice. How many would have chosen Earth? What gave Victor Isa the right to choose for them?
You see the hypocrisy in what the emissary is saying, right? They don't want to rob people of their free will, but then they steal the artifacts for themselves.
In the wrong hands, the power of the artifacts can make anyone a tyrant. That's why we watch over them. The only thing you're watching out for is yourself.
The emissary's right. The artifacts need to be in the right hands. The hunter is right. The only real rule is who gets all the artifacts first. You're both wrong. It's time someone other than a Starborn made a decision.
Don't be a fool. The emissary and I may have our differences, but you do not want to give us a common enemy.
For once, he's right. Don't do this. We can collect the final pieces together.
I'm siding with the emissary. An alliance with the hunter seems like the winning strategy. I'm tired of both of you. I'll get to the Unity on my own. I'm tired of both of you. I'll get to Unity on my own.
Well, look at that. The emissary just became my new best friend.
You've made your choice. When you're ready, the hunter and I will be at the buried temple. That's where we'll settle things.
Meaning, we'll kill you. But hey, at least we'll wait.
I'll take you both right now.
The final round doesn't start until there's only one artifact left to gather. And if I'm not mistaken, Constellation has one or two to go.
Alright then. And I hit level 55. When do I get one of their ships? Damn. Apparently not right now. Alright, Sammy. Alright, my feeling friends, we're going to end episode here. Please like and subscribe, and we will continue this saga in our next episode. Goodbye.